But now let's look at the power that was sought by Simon here. Verse 18, and when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money, saying, give me this power also, that anyone on whom I lay hands may receive the Holy Spirit. But Peter said to him, your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of this your wickedness, and pray God if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are poisoned by bitterness and bound by iniquity. Then Simon answered and said, you pray to the Lord for me, that none of the things which you have spoken may come upon me. So when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, they returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel in many villages of the Samaritans. We actually have a word in our language because of this guy, simony. It's not used very often, but it means those who would buy or sell religious privileges and benefits. And it's all because of this guy's name here. So we look at this and we say, was this guy saved? Not simply because of the request he makes to try to buy the power to give the Holy Spirit, but more because of Peter's reaction. It's a pretty strong reaction against him, with some pretty powerful words saying, you're not right before God. Even when he encourages him, says, you better pray to God, man, maybe he'll forgive you. Notice that Simon's response is, will you pray for him, for me? Simon didn't even have this own relationship of his where he prays, but the idea, well, you do it because God will hear you. And now, as I said, history certainly would suggest this guy is not a believer. A horrible heretic and a big problem for the early church. And once more, those who would want to try to use this difficult passage to build their big doctrine about the lack of eternal security or some sort of thing are mistaken. We don't want to go down that road. I don't think that he was a Christian at any time. And yet, I recognize, you say, well, verse 13, Steve says he believed, got baptized. Certainly, most of the time when in the Bible we read about someone believing, we're reading about them exercising faith in Jesus Christ. Belief and faith, they come from the same Greek word. It usually means a sincere salvation moment. But not always. There are exceptions. For example, if you remember when we were studying John's Gospel, at the end of chapter 2, Jesus had done many miracles and signs in Jerusalem, and it says many people believed in his name, believed in the name of Jesus because of the signs and miracles. But then it says, but Jesus didn't commit himself to them because he knew what was in their hearts. You see, so there you have one example of the Bible saying that someone believed, but they weren't really believing in terms of salvation. It was just the miracles impressed them, and they bought into it for that reason alone. And so we see a little bit of that with Simon as well. If you want a modern example, I believe we have one in the life of Larry Flint. Larry Flint is worth hundreds of millions of dollars today because of pornography. And the most vile, offensive pornography, you say, is there any difference, Steve? It says, well, I hear you, but I mean, his stuff is beyond tasteless. And that's what he's marketed and trafficked in. It's made him very rich. He started out, he was just a strip club owner, had a little magazine, but stumbled across some naked pictures of Jackie Kennedy, and he published them in his magazine, and he became a millionaire, and became very famous as well at the time. And shortly thereafter, Jimmy Carter's sister, who claimed to be an evangelist, but if you read some of the stuff that she believed, you really have to question. For example, the reason she wanted to meet Larry Flint is because she too thought that America was too repressive of sexuality and we needed to be more broad and open in that. Now, she thought, of course, Larry Flint went way too far, but maybe we can talk about this. So they met. And they struck up a friendship for a while. And Larry Flint, one day, flying in his airplane across the country, claimed to have a vision from God and become a born-again Christian. And he claimed sincerity. He went and got baptized too. And he says, I'm going to take my magazine and I'm going to make it more Christian-friendly. Now, I'm still going to have the porn and everything, but I'm going to do away with some of the stuff I was doing. I'll have some articles. And, of course, people in the church say, you can't keep publishing that stuff and making money and claim to be a believer. Well, about a year after this event, he was shot. That's why he's paralyzed today. He's in that wheelchair. Now, by the way, the guy who shot him was not a Christian that was upset at him, like I'm sure many in the media would love to be the story. But he was actually some white supremacist who was upset at, you know, interracial photographs or some crazy thing. But when he got shot, he immediately disowned God. He said, there's no way there's a God for him to allow this tragedy in my life. And he was in tremendous pain and suffering, got addicted to pain pills and everything, and lived as a hermit for several years. But now he's the most rabid atheist you could find. He claims that Christianity is the worst thing that the world has ever created. Now, that guy was never saved. And you look back at his experience, though, he would be very sincere in saying, yeah, I was a Christian at the time. But why did he become a Christian? Because of some vision in connection with what he had been talking to with this probably apostate Christian, you know, so-called Christian lady? Where was the gospel? Where was the call to repentance? Where was the call to a savior because we are sinners? We don't see it in his life. And therefore, it's certainly proper to understand that that's why he turned out the way he did. He was never saved in the first place. See, you're not saved until you believe that Jesus Christ died for your sins and that he rose from the dead. And that is what you have to believe. You have to personalize your sins, your Savior who died and rose for you. We don't read about that in Flint's life. And again, in Simon's case, we don't have all the details, but we do see him more attracted to the miracles than the gospel. And wondering how I can incorporate these supernatural miracles into what I was already doing, which is what? Impressing the people, making them think that I'm somehow the power of God. So I don't believe this guy was ever a Christian, just like Larry Flint was never a Christian. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 19, and I'll paraphrase, John basically says, talking about the false teachers, they went out from us because they were never really of us. Because if they were of us, if they were believers, then they wouldn't have gone out. But they went out so that it would be manifest to all that they were never really believers. And that's what you see in a guy like Flint's life. Now he's out there, he's a rabid atheist. Well, he was never a believer in the first place. That's why he went out of the church. That's why you don't see him in the fellowship. That's why he never repented of his sins. Now, notice, I'm not saying that I doubt Simon's salvation because of the question he asked. Because that's our normal response. We say, how could that guy or that lady really be a Christian and do such a horrible sin? And let me tell you, every one of us as Christians is capable of doing the most horrible, scandalous sins you can imagine. You don't ever want to take that judgment. The flesh is powerful. We can be stupid, not do the things we know we're supposed to do in our walk with the Lord, and begin that downward spiral until it leads to destruction. And you can do it as a true believer in Jesus Christ who's going to heaven.